Hello everybody and welcome to another War Thunder upcoming content video. I apologize that I missed this somehow. I didn't notice because it was swamped by other news posts about as soon as it was posted. The moment that I opened up my Discord and War Thunder website, there was already two more posts on the news, and this one was right above the Sendai light cruiser that we looked at last time. So it just kind of blended in and I didn't notice it. But I re-looked over it and realized, oh, hey, I missed this. This is the Isuzu, which is an upcoming Japanese ship. It is a frigate, obviously. So it is more of a modern, not big class World War II, World War I ship. Or at least should say post-World War II, as you can see here, early 1960s. However, just as last time, I would like to take a little bit to talk about. I'm not going to be complaining about this ship or anything, but I would like to address some of the discussion that was brought up in regards to my mini rant I went on in the last upcoming content video when I covered the Sendai. And that rant, just as a quick recap, was basically me saying that for the first time basically in my War Thunder content history, I was upset that Japan was yet again falling behind in what should be their most powerful tech tree. And other nations are getting their, top-of-the-line heavy cruisers. I shouldn't say top-of-the-line, but I should say they're getting rank 5 heavy cruisers, because rank 5 is a new thing in naval forces. And they're getting premium light cruisers and all of this kind of, even premium heavy cruisers now. And all this kind of stuff. And Japan is sitting over here. My biggest complaints were, number one, Japan is still not getting some of the best of the line cruisers that they can get, nor are they getting their iconic ones. The Furutaka class is an iconic ship, but it's not the most iconic class of ship that they can have. Japan also is behind in... okay, because one of the things that came up and that I would like to refer to is the fact that some people were, of course, agreeing and some people were disagreeing. Some people were defending Gaijin's decision. Some people were in the same boat as me and were defending that kind of stuff. We're defending on this side of the boat. It's, no pun intended. However, one of the defense in Gaijin's defense that I saw was somebody was saying that Japan already got their heavy cruisers, and they got the Mogami last update, and that is true, they did get the Mogami, but you're missing kind of the point of what I was saying. Japan doesn't have any rank 5s, okay? They did get heavy cruisers, yes, and like I said, they were one of the first nations to finally start upping the ante with heavy cruisers. I even said that in the last video, if I remember correctly. However, not only are they not getting a rank 5 as of now, like Germany and all that kind of stuff, but they also don't have... excuse me, sorry about that. They also don't have any premium cruisers. They don't have a premium light cruiser. They don't have a premium heavy cruiser. And maybe they don't have one yet because they don't have rank 5. You know, maybe they will get one when they decide, hey, Japan should actually get rank 5 naval forces now. You know, or something like that. But United States has it, Germany has it, you know, even Great Britain has it now, and Japan, I mean, something's wrong, you know, when Germany and Great Britain are getting more attention than the Japanese now. That's just, like I said, it's starting to get a little bit unacceptable for me, and it's starting to get really annoying. So, yes, Japan did get their heavy cruisers, did get some, should I say. They got 2 or 3, I think, with the Mogami being the most recent one. They got 2 Furutaka classes, I believe, and they got the Mogami. However, like I said, despite that, all of the reasons I just stated, they're falling behind. And this was one of the mind-boggling things I saw. Okay, because I had more than 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 people message me, and also a couple that posted on the video, that were saying insane things like, Japan has everything they can get. Hello? Hello? Takao class heavy cruiser? What about the Kongo battle cruiser? And even battleships? What about the Fuso or the Yamato or the Nagato? And keep in mind, each of these classifications that I'm talking about are just that. They are the class of ship. There are, the Kongo alone, the battlecruiser, has four ships in its class. The Takao has four heavy cruisers within its class. Each of their battleships have two ships per class. And I'm not even going over every heavy cruiser or every battleship. The only acceptable thing that I saw somebody say that was sane was that they said the only recognizable battlecruiser Japan has, or should I say had, was the Kongo class. And that's true. That is 100% factual correct. But it had four ships, you know. Yeah, it did. It had four ships in the Kongo class. So there is shit tons of iconic, extremely, exceptionally powerful heavy cruisers alone. So do not sit there and tell me the Imperial Japanese Navy has no more ships that they can get on their tech tree. You are insane if you believe that. Okay? I'm not going to be an asshole and say, go read a book, because there are a ton of vehicles that I've never heard of in the Japanese tech tree alone already, you know, okay? That's how it just works. There's always going to be something that slips through the cracks. But I was under the impression that the ships I just named off are famous. You know, these ships are very well known, with the exception of maybe the Nagato, because I don't hear that one talked about very much. But the Fuso, the Takao, the Kongo, all of these, and yes, the Yamato, obviously. In fact, it could be argued that the Yamato, the Bismarck, and other ships with carrying those names are probably the most iconic ships in history. But I'm going to kind of leave the Yamato out, since it's a battleship, the largest of its kind to ever be built, that we'll probably not see in War Thunder anytime soon, if at all. But considering they have announced a larger class of ship to be coming to the game, well, we'll definitely probably at least see battlecruisers, hopefully soon. And that was one of the things I was really excited about for update 1.95. I thought, holy shit, you know, now we can get battlecruisers and all that kind of stuff. And we got, you know, this is the thing. I'm not complaining that Germany gets what they got. I'm complaining that Japan is falling behind. You know, I love the fact that Germany is getting the Eugen and all that kind of stuff. They're gorgeous ships. They're beautiful. They're large. They're pretty. But Japan has so many things that they could have that they should have, you know? I mean, come on, really. And one of the things that I saw a lot of the people that were reposting and commenting in replies to the people I'm talking about, were talking about, a lot of people have been talking about the Takao class and how they would love to see that in the game. I absolutely agree. In fact, the Takao class is the heavy cruiser I want to see the most in War Thunder right now. And it can be any of them. I would personally prefer her lead ship, the Takao. But there are, of course, three other ships of her class, and there is one that is far more iconic than the Takao herself. So that one might probably come to the game. In fact, I honestly could see Gaijin adding the Takao as the premium heavy cruiser for Japan. And if they do that, I would be very satisfied, provided they don't add the iconic one again as the premium. That would be a little disappointing, but at the very least, they would finally get their premium cruiser that they lack at the moment. You know, this same goes for the rest of the nations in the game too, okay? You know, Germany and the United States and Great Britain and stuff, they have these ships that are in the game now that are part of a class of ship that already have, you know, that have three or more ships within that class, but in the game we only have one or maybe two of that class. You know, there's still missing components in between, so there's still room for plenty of content across all of the nations. You know, Japan alone has two Furutaka ships. Again, if I remember correctly, I believe they have two Furutakas. So, you know, like I said, there's still lots of content room here. And I said I'm biased towards the Japanese Navy. I have been my whole life. You know, long before I even really gave a shit about Japan, the Japanese Navy was always the one I rooted for in video games and in movies and stuff. I thought they were glorious. I love them so much that, of course, I'm going to be one of the first to come to the defense. But it just blew my mind when I hear somebody say, Japan has everything that they can have right now. Hello? Come on. Be reasonable, please. Okay. In fact, I don't think that exists anywhere. The only time you can rightfully say they have everything that they can have is when Gaijin fully adds every possible vehicle that has ever existed for a single nation. That's the only time you can rightfully say that, at least in my opinion. Like I said, I think I said this in one of my recent videos as well, it might have even been in the Sendai video, I said, I want every variant of every vehicle in the game, no matter how little the difference is. I know that I am one of the very few that believes in that kind of opinion, but that's just how I like it. And that's why I'm always disappointed when Gaijin adds things like the BMP-1P as a modification unlock rather than a standalone vehicle. Okay, so the 10-minute rant on trying to once again defend the Japanese Navy one more time. You know, and just as a closing statement before we finally get into the dev blog, I just want to say, you know, just like in my Sendai video, I'm not complaining about the Sendai, I'm not complaining about the Isuzu, I'm complaining about the fact that they are behind in the other classes of ships right now, and the ranks and stuff like that, when there are far better choices out there that they could be going for, and it's just confusing to me right now. And I just want to stress one more time, guys, this is pretty much the first time I've ever complained about something like this. Before, I didn't really give a shit. I just wanted more and more stuff in the game. You know, when Japan didn't have their main battle tank or anything, I wasn't complaining like a lot of people were. You know, when Japan had these big gaps in their ground tech tree, sure, it's annoying, but I wasn't complaining when other nations got stuff. And, you know, I was kind of like, is Japan going to get something or are they not, you know? I never kind of sat out and did what I did here. This is kind of the first time. So that should show you. It should try to at least give you some idea of how this upsets me in the game. So, yeah. Anyways, guys, let's get on to the Isuzu dev vlog that you have come along for. Okay, so the Isuzu class was a group of four frigates built for the JMSDF in the early 1960s as a replacement for older vessels in service at the time. Soon, captains will have the opportunity to take command of this Japanese Cold War era vessel, arriving on War Thunder as part of update 1.95 Northern Wind. Also, I would like to point out that we haven't seen many Swedish planes recently, have we? They showed off the Japanese. They showed off the Swedish tanks, and then some of the ship stuff here. We haven't seen specifically what I'm trying to say is we haven't seen what comes later in the Swedish aviation tech tree. Honestly, I mean, this is kind of a discussion for another time, but honestly, I'd just like to say that there are some jet-powered aircraft, honestly, for somebody like me who doesn't like that kind of thing, usually, that I would love to see on the Swedish tech tree, but they're a little bit too modern right now, so I don't think they'll come to the game at least yet. But again, we'll talk about those more when we actually see the Swedish dev vlogs. Okay, so this is the Isuzu. It is a frigate of the Japan for the second rank. The pros are that it has quick-firing main battery guns, high crew count, good survivability. The cons, however, are that it lacks armor. And here we have some shots of this. Look at that. It looks like a penis. That thing looks ridiculous. And then, of course, here we've got central portion. Oh, they don't show an ass shot. That's kind of disappointing. Maybe we'll get one down below. And here we've got some history on the unit. In War Thunder, the frigate Isuzu will appear in Rank 2 of the Japanese Naval Forces tree with the arrival of the next major update coming to the game. Unlike its predecessor, the Chikugu, a familiar vessel to some sailors, Isuzu is an older design, but one that offers enhanced firepower and survivability, traits that will most certainly be welcomed by many captains. On its firepower, Isuzu features a similar primary armament arsenal to Chikugo, although doubled in quantity. As a result, Isuzu offers its aspiring captains access to four 3-inch or 76mm rapid-fire cannons spread across two twin turrets. One on either end of the ship's hull. Furthermore, captains will also have a single center-mounted quad-barreled 324mm torpedo launcher at their disposal, which you could see in one of the images up here, but like I said, they're probably going to show us a proper one. However, unlike Chikugo, which, man, they like saying unlike, Isuzu doesn't offer any sort of secondary weapon system to back up the main guns, disregarding the torpedo armament, of course. This means that future captains of the ship will need to be extremely cautious of sort of engagements that take part in a and maintain a high degree of situational awareness, given that they will have to be required to keep an eye out and manually engage targets both on surface and in the air. Fortunately, however, the primary guns do offer a wide selection of ammunition choices, giving you the necessary flexibility in battle. Another important improvement the Isuzu offers over its more modern counterpart concerns survivability, thanks to the slightly larger size allowing it to accommodation of 18 whole more sailors to blow to pieces on board compared to the Chikugo. Isuzu's total crew count is therefore brought up to 183, inherently making it more capable of absorbing battle damage and offering overall greater resilience as a result. And here we've got some more shots of the ship. There we got a shot of the forward weaponry, and then the rear end. So as you can see, it's got no secondary batteries or anything back here, just the torpedoes. That's what they mean by situational awareness here. Well, it does have this, though. They didn't talk about that. Maybe they just mean it doesn't have any secondary weaponry, like secondary batteries or anything. Okay. Despite these differences, Isuzu and Chikugo share nigh-identical performance figures when it comes down to mobility, with both ships being able to reach a top speed of 26 knots, 48 kilometers an hour. Therefore, captains eager to command the newcomer Isuzu will likely feel right at home with the new vessel if they've already gained some experience behind the wheel of the Chikugo. Isuzu is arriving soon to rank 2 of the Japanese Naval Tree with the release of upcoming War Thunder Update 1.95 Northern Wind, and will become available to all captains. Okay, so that is a new frigate for a Cold War frigate for the Japanese naval forces. If there is anything that, I'm not interested in this ship at all. I'm just going to come right out and be honest. I really don't care about this. And that's it's great addition, but I don't care about the unit itself. And that just comes simply down to the fact that this is not my era. For ground forces, I have loved to admire modern tanks, and in fact, even in War Thunder, I have come to actually enjoy driving them now, when previously it was the worst game part of the game for me, period. There are still lots of problems, though, that I have with it, but I am at least able to enjoy modern tanks in the game. However, when it comes to my interest in modern technology, if you were to rank it based on, like, what am I interested in most from top to bottom? Top being my most interesting and bottom being my least interesting. And you rank aircraft, like planes, helicopters, ships, and tanks. And it would go in this order. At the very top would be tanks. I am most interested in modern ground technology, because I think that that's where it's still the most diverse. I am then most interested in helicopter modern technology, because helicopters are fucking badass. Then I am most interested in aviation technology, aircraft, planes. And that's dropped heavily from the helicopter rating. There's some really nice looking, supersonic jets out there. There's some really nice looking currently, in use. Oh God, that hurt. In use, modern fighters. But the fact of the matter is, for me, I just don't find them interesting at all. And then at the very bottom of the list are modern ships, and probably, thankfully, this isn't a modern ship, as in what we use now, but I think they're some of the most ugly and disgusting designs I've ever seen in history, period. They just look horrible, and I don't think they'd be really any fun to play, in my opinion, simply and purely because of how ugly they are. But, hey, don't judge a book by its surface, by its cover. Maybe they'd be fun to play. Doesn't mean I need to be interested in them, though. And this is getting closer to those kind of designs, where it just turns less from the good old, big boys with big guns to little boys with little guns that fire fast. And I don't find that really fun at all in the game currently. Okay, so if you haven't been paying attention to the recent dev blogs, here are some others that were announced for upcoming update 1.95. With some of the other ships for naval forces coming, such as the Japanese light cruiser Sendai, which we talked about last time, The Germans are getting the rank 4 premium Eugen, which is a heavy cruiser. They're also getting a rank 5 heavy cruiser, the Graf Spee, and then we have the British Australian HMAS Tobruk, rank 3 destroyer. Of course, Swedish Aviation is coming to the game. They're getting their tech tree. The J6B2 will be their reserve biplane fighter. They're also getting the B3C, which is an export version of the Ju-86, the German bomber. They're also getting the B-17A and B-17B, which are Swedish light bombers. And they're getting the J-22A and J-22B, which are Swedish fighters. Then, the Swedish are also getting two premium tanks. Next update, they are not getting their ground forces tech tree, but they are getting their tanks at least. And those will consist of the rank 2 SAV 2012-48, which is a self-propelled gun that fires once every 1.6 seconds, I believe, with a 120mm gun. And then, of course, they're getting their rank 5 prototype to the serial production version of the STRV, the STRV 103-0, excuse me, the STRV 103, and that would be the 103-0. Then for ground forces, other than that, the British have had the Roycat 76 Mark 1D announced, which is their upcoming wheeled tank destroyer. It is actually a South African tank destroyer, and it is very nice looking. And then last but not least, Naval Forces is also getting a new location, the New Zealand Cape. But yeah, so lots of, presumably lots of Swedish stuff still left for them to announce, but we're at the 12th of December here. We're getting closer and closer to the release date of the update, because we usually always get the last update of the year in December. It's been that way for about as long as I can remember anyways, and, you know, we're about to be halfway through the month here, so, you know, mark your calendars. Update 1.95 is coming very, very, very soon, and, well, I'm excited to see what else we have in store for Sweden, at least. And, anyways, thanks for watching. Let me know what you think about this new upcoming frigate in the game, and I'll see you next time. Okay, I want to come in, since we already made this video into, like, a kind of mini discussion video anyways, I kind of wanted to cover some of the comments in the actual dev blog post here, because, it's not often that this happens, but the administrator, I kind of feel bad for in this case, because he's in a position that feels a little bit stressful, I can imagine, and that is, of course, SM in 1080p, which we haven't had agreed opinions in the past, a lot, in fact, but this time I kind of want to come up to his defense on some of these comments, and I just kind of want to go over that quick. Now, the first thing, a big disclaimer, is that, you know, everybody wants different things in the game. None, you know, even when you do something that the community really wants, you know, there's going to be a chunk that didn't want it, or a chunk that didn't give a shit, you know, or something like that. And thus, there's always going to be a group of people that are either happy or upset, no matter what happens in the game. And that's just a fact of any game, really. So just take that part with a grain of salt as we go into this. So, first, I would like to come to the anti-air guy here, 19 hours ago. He says, "What? Really? Another ship barely anyone is going to play? Is this update supposed to be about Sweden, or what?" And the response that 1080p gives is, "This update is about Sweden mostly, yes. However, it's also about filling and expanding existing areas of the game, which is something people constantly ask for." And this is true. People are asking for a lot of stuff, okay? But if there is one thing that I can definitely agree I have heard asked about a shitload, is, you know, fill in these gaps, fill in these gaps, fill in these gaps. Maybe, you know, people will argue, well, we're asking about ground forces or aircraft. We need gaps filled there. And there are still some tech trees with some mega gaps. Sometimes I don't think they can really fit anything in there. But, like, for example, they even said in one of the Q&As over the past couple months, I don't remember how long ago it was, that Italy has a lot of gaps on their tech tree, ground forces tree, but they have plans for stuff to put in there. You know, so even nations that have some gaps that make sense, they still have something planned somehow to put somewhere in there, and that's neat. Naval forces is something I can't really say, because my naval progress throughout most of the tech trees, you know, isn't that far, so I can't say, oh my god, this gap is the worst thing ever. You know, but it does get annoying in ground forces when I come up, you know, on the tech tree and there's a gap and I'm stuck with one tank at its battle rating, and the, you know, the, all the other tanks I have in my lineup are 0.3 or 0.7 lower than the tank I'm driving, you know, or even worse if I'm grinding the tech tree for the first time. So I can understand where people's frustrations will come from. Okay, now, I also in here we have somebody called Cat Clan Leader. You wouldn't happen to be a Warrior Cats fan, would you? Anyways, this person says, in response to 1080p's message, it will probably cost more RP than their top rank heavy cruiser. Honestly, I don't get why rank 2 boats are this expensive. And somebody even responds to this. And this is, right here, it's basically kind of what I'm about to say anyways. And that's because it doesn't work like the rest of the game, Mr. Cat Clan Leader, okay? This isn't a vertical tech tree where you work from the top down to the bottom. It's a horizontal tech tree where you work from left to right. You start with, on the left, a rank, you know, like the first rank 2, which starts on the left, is basically equivalent to a rank 2 plane that you would get right after your first rank 1, and you would immediately go to rank, you know, the next rank 2, and then rank 3, and rank 4, and all that kind of stuff. But because you're working from left to right, you progress along a different progression path. The ships get progressively better as you go from left to right, not top to bottom. The whole difference is that each rank separates the class of ship. I guess you could say except ranks 1 and 2, but rank 3 for a very long time has been destroyers, rank 4 is cruisers, and now rank 5 is making the big ships, which consists of some heavy cruisers, if Germany's anything to go by, and will most definitely probably include battle cruisers, and then I'm assuming rank 6 or something like that will probably be battleships or very large class of ships that are very powerful in what they do, things like that, you know. So it's been this way for a while. That's why they cost so much RP. It's not, why is this thing so expensive for rank 2? It's because you're progressing kind of, you're going through the service years from left to right instead of top to bottom. Okay. So, the next question is, that it? Where is rank 5 and 7 stuff? What about USA, France, Italy? Guys, it is going to be a long winter at this pace. Okay. This... the only thing I would say about rank 5 that I could agree with is if he's talking about, like, rank 5 Japanese naval forces, because we already kind of went over that in our discussion. But this 1080p's response here is perfect, because it's like, this is the definition of any community. People constantly, not everybody, mind you, I'm not claiming everybody, but people constantly complain that ranks 1 through 4 aren't getting enough attention, and all Gaijin gives a shit about these days is top tier, right? And that's true, they've been giving a lot of attention to top tier, though I also have a defense for them in that. They should be giving a lot of attention to top tier right now, because it still needs a lot more content compared to World War II, but I am also in support of World War II content and would love to see that more than modern content, honestly. However, I understand why they put most of their resources towards modern tanks on each of the existing tech trees, okay? I fully understand why they do that, and I can agree with that in that case. But you get people that complain about the fact that we're not getting pre-top tier stuff, and then when we start getting something pre-top tier, people start complaining that we're not getting top tier stuff. See? I can only imagine how annoyed, you know, some of these moderators must get sometimes when they have to constantly get put up with this shit. I mean, these guys aren't being paid enough, okay? The 1080p, he's probably not being paid enough to put up with this shit, I have to be honest. And he even says in his response that while you may not personally find this for you every update, this sort of thing is what people ask to see. Not always just new shiny top toys. And that's true. It's not always about the top shiny toys, and it's not always about the World War II tanks either. Or ships, you know. And this is, of course, not a World War II ship or anything, but I agree with him on this case as well. And we scroll down to even the very next top comment that says, another ship. And he does it. He emphasizes another ship here, and I want to point that out as a detail. It's only been the fifth one after all, right? Oh, hold on. Excuse me. Can we expect the Japanese to get something that is not a boat, and the French to get anything at all? I mean, I'd love the Japanese to get a ship too, to be honest. And, you know, France. I mean, I would love to see French naval forces. And where is Italy? I'm honestly, actually, that's something I would love to hear Gaijin talk about. They have talked about it in Q&As. But where is Italy? Why is it still not in the game? You know, where's... We had their we had some of their naval forces in the oldest naval tests. So, where are they? You know, but I don't know. Anyways, again, I love 1080p's response because he kind of mocks the commenter by saying, yes, indeed, and then repeats the same exaggerated another underscore ship thing. They are one of the newest classes of vehicles in the game, and we are filling the gaps in existing trees as well as developing higher rank content for them also. Again, I fully agree with 1080p on this because naval forces are the newest class of ship in the game. You know, ground forces, for example, has been in the game since, I mean, if you want to consider the closed testing, it's been in the game since 2013, the end of 2013, but publicly it's been available since 2014. You know, planes have been in the game since, again, publicly 2012, I believe, the end of 2012, and they've been in the game for a very long time. They have the most content. Ships only just, you know, went in like a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, I think. I don't remember if it was it 2000. I think it was 2018, wasn't it? It might have been 2017 or mid 2018. I honestly can't remember when ships went public finally, tech trees. I think it was mid 2018. Correct me if I'm wrong down in the comments, please. But it wasn't that long ago compared to the other vehicle types in the game. And thus, just like with, like I was talking about with modern tanks, when they just kind of went in and they're slowly adding content to them, they need more content to fill out. There are gaps on the naval tech trees. Gaijin is filling those. Even if it's a ship I'm not interested in, you know, even this frigate, I don't care about it. You know, it's a cool, neat addition, but it's just not interesting to me. That doesn't mean I don't understand what Gaijin's doing here. You know, they're filling in the gaps, and that's something I can agree with. Okay, so... we do have a response here that somebody comes up with, and they talk about something like the French and Japanese tank trees are not exactly new, yet they are still completely underdeveloped. I can understand where this person's coming from, too. I don't know about France too much, but Japan, you know, they've got one of the smallest tech trees in the game for ground forces, and they've been in the game since the end of 2016. Yes, it's been that long since Japan came out for ground forces, and they still, in fact... I think, I'm not for certain on this, but I think Japan might have had the least work out of all tech trees, aside from, like, Italy. And France doesn't count because it's much bigger than Japan, since it released into the game publicly. I mean, they got, like, the Chinu 2 premium, and they got, like, the premium, you know, Hori prototype and stuff, so they got a couple premiums in there. And then you look at their standard tech tree. For their top tier... they've only gotten a few new additions, the Type 89, the Type 90, and that recent SPG that they got, you know, stuff like this. That's not many compared to something like a different nation that might have gotten a ton of them. But then at the same time, Japan isn't the other nation. It doesn't have a million, you know, variants of T-series tanks or Abrams to ship out. However, Japan does have other main battle tanks that they could have on the tech tree that I guess either Gaijin's working on, they don't want to put in right now, maybe it's too powerful, I don't know. I'm sure some of you know what one I'm talking about specifically, the one that I see a lot of people asking for right now. But yeah, Japan has some other World War II tanks that are in variants of tanks already in the game that they could have that they don't have yet, that haven't been added for a very long time. So I can understand where he's coming from. I do believe... Japan is a little underdeveloped in its tank tech tree, especially for how many years it's been out now and how little work it's had compared to the overall essence of ground forces. But I don't know, maybe they'll change that over time. Well, they will change that over time, but okay. So that's about it for the official administrator responses. I just wanted to throw that in at the end because I thought it would be interesting to look at the community's response to some of the naval additions as of late. But yeah, a lot of people don't like naval forces, and somebody down below in the comments also says that naval forces is like the least played part of the game, and that is true. It is statistically the least played out of the three, air, ground, and sea It's also the most recent, and it's also very early, in my opinion. It still has a lot of work to go for it. But just because it's the least played, guys, doesn't mean it's not being played, period. It's just like Simulator. Simulator is the least played of arcade, realistic, and simulator. But there is still a very dedicated fan base to Simulator mode, and I adore Simulator as well. I just play realistic most of my time, mainly because that's where everyone else I play the game with plays realistic. And Naval Forces is the same. I think Naval Forces has a lot of work yet that it needs to go through, and there's some quality of life improvements it should get, but just because it's the least played doesn't mean it's irrelevant.